may not have time for that in the way that you organize your time, or maybe it's not productive. I'm here to challenge you to study in different ways, to manage your time in different ways, to look at bad habits and unravel them. That's what I want from you. And to me, that is the baseline for success in this class. All right, so the texts. I want the class, obviously, to be paperless as much as I can. Here are some digital texts that are in the Moodle. And I don't have assigned readings in them. There is some assigned readings early on, correlated readings, not assigned, but correlated readings for the first half of the class. Those are in the Moodle, and you can follow those. But I'm not trying to force you to get into those textbooks if they're not working for you. But they're digital, and you don't need to buy anything. I would say that this book is meh. It's fine. This book is a very concise description of the physiology. And this guy, Frank Netter, who did the illustrations in that, is one of the true greats of 20th century anatomical illustration. So it's got good pictures. Then for the lab, these are the books. So again, this is all digital. You don't have to buy any of this. This is a really lovely, lab text that you can peruse. Again, this is a dissector, very beautiful drawings. That's what I used when I was in medical school. And then this is also what I used in medical school. The finesse. This one, for anyone who's planning to go on to medical school or nursing school. This is almost required. I mean, it's such a useful book that you can keep the digital copy for yourself. However, if you want a hard copy, I have ordered them to the bookstore for anybody who wants a hard copy. This is the main textbook, the newest edition. The digital one I have is an older edition. This is the lab manual written by this guy, Michael Wood, that I worked with in Texas. In the anatomy department at Del Mar. And then this is the print copy of The Finesse, if you like a book in your hands. It is really handy. It's the complete anatomy. It's like Gray's Anatomy without all the descriptions, but just the osseous features and the features of the different anatomical components into a condensed, easy reference. So that's a nice book if you want to buy it. But that's totally up to you. All right, so these are all my expectations and stuff. I've already sort of hit the list here. I want to help train professionals, and because of that, I'm expecting professionalism. I'm going to try to be professional. That doesn't mean I'm going to be uptight. I'm probably going to take my shoes off and walk around barefoot at some point in the class. That I don't see that as being unprofessional. Professional means being here on time, working hard, being ethical, not cheating, because what's the point of cheating? The point is not to get a grade here. You'll get the grade you deserve, no matter what. I am going to ask for 100% commitment to the class. I expect that. I am totally committed myself. I'm working hard, and I want that from you. A lot of students get freaked out at this point, and I always get a couple of drops the next day. I hope that's not the case. I don't want to scare anyone away. It really is an opportunity being here. What have you guys heard about this class? Had anybody heard anything about this class from anybody? Ryan, you like have a smile hidden there. No? What's that?
I heard it's really hard.
Yeah, that's probably a common thing that you hear. Has anyone heard that before? Yeah. The course is hard, and it's hard by design. The hardest thing about this course is wrapping your head around what I want you to do. I'm not trying to get you to jump through the same hoops that every instructor is getting you to jump through. Getting 100% on all the quizzes and tests and the grand rounds and all the things that are graded is not what's hard about the class. You can get an A and still fail lab exams. In fact, I expect probably 60% of the class to fail the first lab exam, because that's typical. To me, what is hardest about this class is giving up your preconceived notions about what it means to study. So many students feel like they have to get stressed out to do well in a class, to rise to meet the challenge of a course with a lot of content. That's not what I want. In fact, I want the opposite. All right? You guys understand where I'm coming from? This is an opportunity. JanPlan is like one of the only chances you get. I have you mind, body, and spirit here. No other classes. You probably have some sports. Are there any sports athletes in here? A couple of you guys. You have the extra challenge. It is an extra challenge for you. But you can do it. It's good to learn how to balance. All right, so obviously I want critical thinking, written and verbal communication skills. There's only one actual exam in the class. It's the final, and it's entirely written. There are going to be quizzes interspersed throughout, usually on a fairly regular daily basis. Maybe sometimes I will quiz you over the material that we're going to talk about in class, and I'm not going to tell you what days I'm doing that. Often it will be a review of what we talked about in the last class, all right, just to keep you on your toes. Don't worry about that. That's helping you check in with reality. And then the verbal skill part is going to be the Grand Rounds oral project. We'll talk about that. And there are some blog posts that I'm going to ask you to do at the end of the semester just to see how you write, how you process, how you communicate, internalize information, digest it, and externalize it. Okay, so my concept of success, like the baseline, if you want an A in this class, you need to figure out how to be healthy. I don't want healthcare professionals that are unhealthy. Well, I'm thinking of it, Amy. Thanks. Yeah. That means getting the appropriate amount of rest at night. Get enough sleep. How many people would say that they don't get enough sleep on a consistent, regular, daily basis? Anybody in here? Yeah, half the class. That's typical. That's a problem. That's a problem in our society. Why are our most talented people going out into the world not getting enough sleep? Athletes. You're asking that from your body, but then you're not giving your body what it needs. You gotta get rest. I do not want that you to do well in this class at the expense of your sleep, because that's not doing well in this class in my mind, okay? Am I hitting this theme over and over? Regular, balanced, nutritionally appropriate meals, particularly the athletes. You probably need more food than most people. Make sure you're eating healthy, regular meals. Don't skip breakfast. I hate having you here in class falling asleep, not having the food inside yourself that you may need. Be physical on a regular basis. That can be hard, I know. It can be hard, I know. Find ways to make room for it, even if it's just walking in the arb. Get outside. Move your body. Okay, and to keep your stress at a 3 or below, what are you talking about? So, let's see what I got here. I'll get to that. yeah, this stress or a three or below. I'm handing out this lifestyle log. I'm going to ask you to keep a daily log of how much sleep you get, how much physical activity you get, and what type. Your meals, and I want you to rate your stress on a scale of 1 to 3. 1 being you are on a beach in the Virgin Islands, 5 being your head's about to explode, and a 3 is what I consider to be healthy. A 4 is where most people find themselves, 4 or 5. Okay, we're going to do this together because for the first time, this JanPlan, this is not my sole commitment. I am also teaching high school at the Snow Pond Arts Academy for the first time. It's an arts-based charter high school, and I teach there from 1:15 till 5 o'clock every day. Bunch of science and math classes to smart, lovely children from Central Maine. So it's going to be a challenge for me, too, to maintain a stable, healthy lifestyle, keep my stress level down. I'm going to work hard at it. I think I have the tools, and I want to share them with you. So hopefully this is going to be useful to you. I'm going to collect it on the last day of class. It's going to give me a way, be honest, there's no reason to lie on this, or like the last day, like scribble a bunch of stuff in there. That doesn't do you any good. Take the opportunity. I mean, you can do that, you know, I'm not, it's you're on your honor, obviously, but it should be a tool to help you see where you're at, okay? All right, so let's look at the schedule a little bit. Has anybody looked at this already? Man, we do need a new bulb. That bulb is horrible. Yeah, it should be white and gray sections, but you can't see that. This week, we start with lecture, followed by lab. We'll go upstairs into Airy 307 and have lab up there. Next week and the following week, we start with lab. So in the beginning of class, we'll meet up there at 9 o'clock, and then we'll come down afterwards. The way I've organized this is so that lab, which is where the anatomy is taught, precedes the lecture where we talk about the physiology. That way you learn the anatomy, and then we talk about what it's doing in lecture the following day. That's why I've designed it this way. Okay? Where you see the Q1, Q2, Q3, these are where you can count on there being a quiz. You can count on there being a quiz in there over the material in the region of that quiz. What else do I want to point out? So there's a number of fun activities. Yeah, that's right. I need to talk about this. So typically in Jan Plan, I have 16 class periods with you guys, and I try to use them to their fullest. Unfortunately, this year, because of the way the calendar falls, class didn't start until a Tuesday, which throws me off a little bit. I can chop some stuff out of this. It's going to derange the calendar a little bit. Not chopping something out, I would ask you if there are any conflicts for class meeting once and only once this coming Friday. I will not have you any other Friday, but that enables me. Are there any conflicts? Is there anybody who can't come on a Friday? The entire day?
I have to leave at like 10.
Okay. That's okay. So in the afternoon, in the second half of the class on Friday, there's this field trip to the art museum. You would miss that. And there is a lab exam, but we can come up with another way for you to deal with that, if that's okay with you. Does anybody else have opposition to me talking about muscles on Friday? Okay, well, that's what it's going to be. This Friday, there's class, so we're able to get I'm able to give you the full experience. What else? Next Thursday, not this coming Thursday, but next Thursday, I have Dr. Zach Nashid right over here. He is an interventional radiologist. He's going to come in to lab and give a pretty interesting discussion to everybody about what he does. And that day we'll do a wet dissection of a pig heart. That should be a fun thing for everybody. One of the big project with this semester is this thing called Grand Rounds. Let me see if I can get over here. So here's the objective component of the class, the things that are actually going to be grades that you can quantify. There's Lab Practical 1, which will be on Friday, the first lab test. The Art and Anatomy activity, which is after it, which should be, everybody should get almost all the points on that. It's pretty easy and fun. And then there's this BMI map activity that will be you'll do over the weekend. Their metabolic analysis lab. We're going to go into the gym towards the end of the semester with Dawn Strout. Does anybody know her? Yeah, we'll work with her, and that should be a fun day of learning about ways to quantify various physiological metrics in your body. And then this grand rounds that you see here. Now, grand rounds itself is a time-honored tradition for continuing education in the medical profession. Grand rounds are where the chief attending physician would take the interns and other residents, perhaps, on the rounds of the floor, and they would present interesting medical cases to them. So it's a little bit of theater here. You're going to do that. You guys are going to pair up into groups and give presentations to the group about a particular topic. And I suggest, actually, a specific case. This blue link here, the New England Journal of Medicine database, that is Harvard's teaching hospital. It's out of the New England Journal of Medicine, which is the journal associated with Harvard Medical School. And it's a whole set of clinical pathologic cases. So case studies, interesting ones, well documented. What's nice about them is I've developed a nice friendship with the woman who manages that database down in Cambridge. And if you're interested in one of them, she will send me the original PowerPoint and often any video files and any extra files that the physicians who originally presented the case used. They archive all that down there. So you won't be able to use that exact PowerPoint, but it puts you leagues ahead of other people. You have slides that are composed in a coherent manner for you. So that's a major resource that you should seriously take advantage of. Sometimes students, however, have issue topics that they want to discuss that are not cases. We've had people just talk about kidney transplant or whatever, all kinds of topics, whatever you find interesting. It doesn't have to just be in there, okay? But that's in the path of least resistance for people who want to follow it. And then that talk will be given for a grade to the group, open to the public. But we're also going to go down to Maine General Hospital in Augusta and team up with Dr. Michael Lacombe's third year medical students at the New England School of Medicine on their medical rounds down there. And you will present your talks to that group as well. It is so supporting. Do not get intimidated. They offer nothing but support and interesting discussion. You're going to find it very, very enjoyable. You'll get to break up with the medical students, and they will tour you around in small groups around the whole medical facility. You can ask them all kinds of questions about the process of getting into medical school, and blah, 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 this and that, the other thing. So that should be a fun thing. Then there's some more lab practicals, and then finally the final exam. So, yeah, I think I've gone through all those personal traits, preparedness. Please take advantage of your class time. So without going into this in detail, I can give you a lot of study strategies for this material in excruciating detail if you want it. I'm not going to do it here for everybody. But I know this material backwards and forwards. I know how to study it. I can help you learn how to study it. Each class that you take, different material may lend itself to different study approaches. A good tool that you should have is learning how to adapt your study routine, your study strategy to the material you have. And I can help you with this material if you want. That just seek me out. So one thing I would say, each study session, this is one real common thing. very general thing. Every time you study, spend a third of the time reviewing what just happened in class. Spend a third of the time reviewing all the material since the last test or in that section, the broad section. Like going back, basically, and reviewing everything that's come before. And then a third of the time, looking ahead at what's coming in the next class. Even if you feel like you haven't reviewed everything that you wanted to review, spend some time looking ahead every time. Students get behind. You can never catch yourself up if you're never looking ahead. Okay? Always commit yourself to some time looking ahead. Always commit yourself to some time looking ahead. You'll have such a better experience, not just here, but anywhere. Really, you're going for a job. They're hiring in the ES department. My wife is in the Environmental Studies department right now. They're hiring someone, and they were interviewing 120 people. This one woman stood out well above all the others. She did her homework. That woman came to the interview. She knew about the research that everybody in the department had done. She'd read their papers. She'd investigated Waterville already. She had it together, and she stood out because of that. That's what you want. Be prepared ahead of time. Be thorough. All right. But it's juice per squeeze. Always get enough sleep. Hopefully that's 8 hours for you. Maybe 7, maybe 9. Probably not 6, and probably not 11. Find the right balance. Okay, I can tell you how to take interesting notes. Probably a lot of you already know how to do this properly, but talked about that. Oh, and then lastly, so I practice Ashtanga yoga, and I teach Ashtanga. My class currently is at 5:30. In the Millet House on Wednesday evenings. You don't have to come at all. I wish it were in the middle of the day, but it's not right now. So it's a lovely practice. If anyone's been in the Millet House, it's in that big wooden thing. This is a great way to get a little bit of mindful activity. Build some core strength, some balance, learn how to breathe, and I'll actually talk about quite a bit of anatomy in there as we do the yoga, if you want to. Here are the correlates. The nice thing about Ashtanga, and this is the last bit of advertising I'll give it, is that it's a sequence. So once you learn the sequence, you don't have to go to classes all the time for Ashtanga. It's designed for self-practice. Once you learn it, you can just do it on your own without having to be at a class. It's a good tool to have. So there's that. There's the advertisement. All right. Lecture 1, intro, homeostasis, and then bones. How finely crafted this ship of fools, sail and beam, fleeting flesh and bone. All right. You are all part, just sitting in this class makes you part of a truly ancient and multicultural tradition. It is a profoundly human tradition. The desire to understand the human body, its functioning, both in the ideal and in its illness and dysfunction. Here's an example. This is the first Egyptian medical text out of ancient Egypt, 1600 BC. Over 3,500 years ago in North Africa, we have the first medical text. I'm not going to assign you to translate that for me, but that is pretty astounding to me. I find it beautiful. I find it beautiful. What a lovely thing. All right. The Greeks and the Romans are so celebrated because they had such an impact, a well-documented impact. They documented their ideas. This guy, Hippocrates, they think of him as the father of medicine. He was a Greek living in the 4th century BC. The modern, when you become a physician nowadays, they ask you, a standard allopathic physician, they ask you to take the Hippocratic Oath. So all of this, you can write this down, you can take notes on this. This is for your edification. The history is here to help you understand that you are part of this ongoing living tradition, this tapestry throughout the ages. I'm not going to test you on this stuff. You can take the notes if you wish. This is good stuff to know, though, so you know where all of this has come from. So Hippocrates took the study of the human body and took it out of the realm of myth. Things that happened to you happened because you had angered the gods, and the gods were intervening directly in your life, pulling a switch, and that's why something goes wrong with you. And he said, look, no, there are physical causes to disease. There are physical causes that we can understand, that you can address. All right? We see here a 12th century Byzantine manuscript of the Hippocratic Oath that he originally penned. Then Aristotle, he further evolved this thinking in the 3rd century, called supernatural causes of disease, teleologi, and natural causes, physiologi. He was trying to balance it out. He wasn't quite ready for Nietzsche and the total death of the gods, right? He was trying to somehow balance the spiritual and the physical. He did have this notion that of emergent properties, that there are complex structures that emerge from simple parts. And this is a profound theme that is manifest now just in basic genetic theory, in basic biochemistry. Your body is made up of 20 amino acids, a host of lipids, carbohydrates, and nucleic acids, five different nucleic acids, eight. All right. He got a few things wrong, though. He believed that nerves were controlled by and originated in the heart, confusing a ligament and a nerve. He didn't really know exactly what a nerve was, but he believed that the soul, the investing spirit of an individual was in the heart and not in the mind. So we got to love Aristotle for that. All right. Galen. I'm going to come back to this guy. He was a Roman. So as philosophical as the Greeks were, these Romans were very practical, sometimes harshly so. He was the physician to the Roman gladiators, sort of like the ancient sports medicine doc, if you will. Brutally intelligent. I will give this guy his due in terms of the insights he had. He also was, a lot of his experiments would be considered grotesque by today's standards, and we'll talk about them with time, but I'm not going to shy away from the contributions this person did. He did animal dissections because it was illegal to dissect cadavers in Roman culture of the time. So a lot of what he learned by studying comparative anatomy on animals. And again, picking up and evolving what Aristotle thought, he saw science as a method of discovery. And so not just a collection of observations that you're going to believe based upon faith. You can test those observations. You can form hypotheses. I think the kidneys are the source of the urine, and the urine gets transported to the bladder. That's my hypothesis. How am I going to prove it? Well, I'm going to open up this monkey's belly and clamp off the ureters and watch the monkey's kidneys explode. Hypothesis tested. Okay, that was the way this guy thought. So He was he's a bit of an arrogant guy. He contradicted Aristotle, though, and quite correctly, disparaging those who, quote, know nothing of what is to be seen in dissection. I have shown in my book, so a little plug for his book here, on teachings of Hippocrates and Plato, that the source of the nerves of all sensation and voluntary motion is the encephalon, or brain, and that the source of the arteries and the innate heart heat is the heart. He did careful dissection and began to untangle what was happening in the human body. All right. So, not to let the Greeks and Romans get all of the fame, the ideas of the cultural cradle of the Mediterranean was also inhabited by the Arabs and the Jews. We have Galen, the Galen of Islam, Avicenna, Ibn Sina. Avicenna was also a remarkable mind for his time, about 800 years after Galen. He wrote the Canon of Medicine. And this Canon of Medicine became the medical Bible for 500 years. For think about that. That's remarkable. 500 years. The medical text this guy wrote was used throughout the Western world and perhaps even into the East for five centuries. That's a tremendous length of time. The United States is not even 250 years old. And he particularly investigated the function of muscles. Moses Maimonides also wrote many influential texts inheriting the mantle from Avicenna. And he was the physician to the Sultan Saladin. All right. Enter Vesalius and the Enlightenment. He was a Flemish physician, and he is the first person in European culture to do exquisite dissection coupled with illustration. All right. Up until this point, a lot of the anatomy was recorded in the art, the sculpture that you may see in any of the galleries. Vesalius made exquisite dissections and illustrations of them. And this was essentially because the Catholic Church allowed for dissection. It was really the church that enabled, you know, changes in the church that, to say enabled is maybe generous, they removed themselves as an impediment, let's say. All right. So this book, De Humani Corporis Fabrica, for any of you, come on. Ugh, what did I do? Okay. So... maybe I'm dawdling too much here. There's these other guys, Servetus, who studied the circulatory system, Harvey, really ushered in sort of modern age of the physician, and he understood the function of the heart as being the pump for the blood. A quantum leap was taken by this guy, Robert Hooke, and it was basically because he was able to connect macroscopic physiology, macroscopic understanding of human health, with microscopic anatomy. All right, so he set the groundwork for cell theory. Why? Because he was able to see them. This is a drawing of his first sight of cork cells. He took a sample of cork, put it under a microscope, and drew what he saw. All right. So then the last little bit of history before I get into a little more conventional discussion here is this guy, Louis Sullivan. All right. And he is... not an anatomist. He is not a doctor. He's not even really a scientist. In fact, He was an architect. He was an architect. But he articulated something in architecture, a theme, a concept that has broad implications throughout the physical world, okay? And does relate to what we're talking about here. He was a devout follower of Charles Darwin. Darwin revolutionized intellectual life in the 19th century with his publication in 1863. In 1896, this guy Sullivan publishes this book, The Tall Office Building Artistically Considered. Now, I'm just going to read it to you. It is the pervading law of all things organic and inorganic, of all things physical and metaphysical. So look, he says, organic and inorganic. Inorganic, my building. Organic, things that are alive, changing. All things physical and even metaphysical, he's reaching. Of all things human and all things superhuman. Of all true manifestations of the head, of the heart, of the soul, that the life is recognizable in its expression, that form ever follows function. This is the law. So this is the first time any intellectual articulated the structure-function paradigm. This is the notion that the function an entity is to serve dictates the structure that it's going to have. That the shape of the glomerulus is what imparts its function. All right? This is the connection between anatomy or structure and physiology or function. Jeez, what are you doing to me here? That was on cue. Perfect. All right. So anatomy. What are the structures? Where are they located? What are the spatial relationships? For those of you who go into medical school and get to do some dissections on a cadaver, it's not just about identify this thing. Look around it. What's around it? You'll be able to identify something by its relationship to other structures. Find a structure you can identify and build relationships off of that nearby. Okay, so it's about anatomical relationships. Gross anatomy versus microscopic anatomy. We will talk about cell physiology. And then physiology, functions of these anatomical structures. There are individual and cooperative functions. This includes the chemistry, biochemistry, genetics, biology. So we're going to talk about all of these levels. The hierarchy of complexity, right? So this is essentially a component, the organismal component of the hierarchy of life, all right? This is the notion that there is this spatial continuum from atoms to molecules to biomolecules or macromolecules that then form organelles, which compose a cell, and cells form tissues, and tissues form organs. Organs form organ systems. Organ systems work cooperatively to form an organism. Then, beyond the scope of this class, organisms live in community. Or organisms live in populations. Populations live in community. Communities make up an ecosystem. Ecosystems make up the biosphere, etc. All right. So the hierarchy of life. This is the organismal component of it. And this is just a chart showing the different ways we can probe these different levels of this hierarchy with transmission EM, scanning EM, compound light microscopes. These are ways of visualizing. MRI is another one, and high field MRI is getting better and better at probing smaller and smaller structures. The whole field of radiology is actually quite sophisticated nowadays. All right, so here is essentially the answer to the first question on the quiz, the different organ systems. And I'm going to go through them one at a time here. The largest organ system in the body is the integument. The integument, your skin. In addition to the skin, there's the hair, the sweat glands, your fingernails. What does it do? Well, it protects you against environmental hazards. All right? If anybody has skinned a large portion of their skin off and then gotten lemon juice on it. So here, I have a burn from my wood-burning stove. And then I was cooking. The other day I was making some guacamole and I got some lemon juice on it. Ow. That doesn't feel good. It protects. It also helps regulate the body temperature. Prevents evaporation. People with severe burns, one of their biggest health threats besides infection is dehydration. It prevents, the skin prevents evaporation of fluids, the fluid loss. It provides sensory information about the world around you. The skeletal system. Made up of the bones and associated soft tissues, including cartilage, ligaments, and bone marrow. A ligament is a connective tissue that holds two bones in relationship to one another. A tendon holds a muscle to a bone. Ligament holds bone to bone, or cartilage to bone. Okay? And then, of course, the bone marrow. The red and the yellow bone marrow. So, obviously, we would be a shambling blob of flesh if we didn't have this rigid structure inside to give our body shape and form. It provides support for all those soft tissues and protection for some, such as the brain. You wouldn't want to be playing catch and get beamed in the back of the head by a baseball if you didn't have a skull there to protect the brain. Besides that, it also stores calcium, other minerals. It's a major repository for calcium. We're going to talk about calcium homeostasis at the end of the class today. It also forms new blood cells. All right, the muscle system, muscular system. Skeletal muscles and the tendons with which they are attached to bone and other muscle. Obviously, they provide movement, but they do provide protection and support for other tissues. There's a famous story about Harry Houdini. I'm from Detroit. I lived down in the city of Detroit when I was young, and one of my early jobs was working at the Majestic Theater down on Woodward Avenue. That was the theater that Harry Houdini sustained the fateful blow. He had this famous challenge that was like out, you know, standing challenge to anybody that he could take a punch to the gut from anybody. And if you could double him over, then you would get some sort of money or whatever. He just had remarkable muscles, right? And then somebody came at him in his dressing room, tapped him on the shoulder. He turned around before he was ready and just socked him in the gut and actually ruptured his spleen, and he died at Henry Ford Hospital later on from that injury. But prior to that, he had taken countless gut shots and always been fine because he was able to protect himself with the muscles of his abdomen. So they certainly do provide protection and support for other tissues. Importantly, they generate heat. They generate heat. This helps maintain your body temperature. You know this if we go out to Quarry Road and some of us who have cross-country skis go or snowshoes go tromping through the woods, we're going to be fine. And those of you who just want to stand around are going to be shivering. The nervous system. In some ways... So what's it made up of first? The brain, obviously. The brain and the spinal cord. Those two
bits comprise the central nervous system. The peripheral nervous system is made up of the peripheral nerves and sense organs. So in some ways, you can think of the rest of the body, all the other systems, as being a life support pod for the nervous system. Okay? We're sort of this weird, squiggly worm surrounded by this fleshy, bony body. It directs immediate response to stimuli. So you prick your finger, you know to take your finger away from the spinning wheel before you fall asleep until your true love comes and wakes you up. And it organizes, moderates the activities of the other organ systems. It's the fast response control mechanism. It's the electrical control mechanism in the body. It is gathering information about the outside world, processing that information, and then responding to that information. It creates the internal world that we experience. It is not the only control system, however. There is a chemical control system. This is the endocrine system. So, and this is a bit of an abstract one because it is not spatially clustered in the body. The endocrine organs are spread out throughout the body. There's various endocrine organs. Sort of the top of the pyramid is the pituitary gland, however. It's sort of the queen endocrine organ. Other subsidiary organs are the thyroid, the pancreas, the suprarenal glands, the gonads, male and female. And there are endocrine tissues in a host of other systems. For example, fat tissue, adipose tissue, has endocrine function in it. So this directs long-term changes in the activities of other organ systems. Your finger's on fire. Ow! That was the nervous system that just reacted. Okay? You're hitting puberty or menopause. This is being coordinated by the endocrine system. Okay? But they interact with one another. They interact. The nervous system and the endocrine system interact with one another. You see a werewolf run into the room looking for its first victim. And your nervous system says, whoa, time to get up. And it sends a signal to the suprarenal glands who do their part and start pumping epinephrine into your blood. So they do interact with one another. The endocrine system controls a lot of these structural and functional changes during the development of lifespan. All right? I unfortunately am not going to get a chance to talk about the endocrine system in this class. I am teaching Human Physiology 275 in the spring, and I'll be talking about it there, although I don't think you're going to be allowed to take that class because you've taken this one. So, biology department needs to clean up that, in my opinion. But, cardiovascular system. So, this is the heart, the blood vessels, and the blood that's being pumped by them. This distributes the blood, the water, the nutrients, oxygen, carbon dioxide, and it's able to distribute heat throughout the body. You can radiate heat by sending blood to the periphery. You can conserve heat by sending blood to the core. Okay? We will talk about the cardiovascular system in great detail. The lymphatic system or lymphoid system. Made up of the spleen, the thymus, your lymphatic vessels, the lymph nodes, and the adenoids and tonsils, and palatine tonsil. We also will not get to talk about the lymphatic system. If you're interested in the lymphatic system, you can take Dr. Hannum's immunology class. I think she probably talks about it there. Maybe not. I don't know if she talks about the anatomy. But it does defend against infection and disease and returns tissue fluids to the bloodstream. Really important. I will touch on it a little bit in the context of other topics. But when you look at this guy here, what do you notice about him? What do you notice about that guy? Yeah. Yeah, right, exactly. Specifically where in the arms and legs? Go ahead, you see it. Where? Mm-hmm. Places where you bend. Places where you move. The lymph in the lymphatic system does not have a pump. There is no heart pumping the lymph around. Lymph circulates through the passive motion of your body, okay? You move your armpits. Those armpits squeeze on the lymph nodes. They kind of slosh the lymph along. You get sick. You get bedbound. This is a problem. This is why bedbound people often have a harder time clearing lymph from their body because they're not moving very much, all right? It's in your neck. It's in your elbows, behind your knees, in your armpits, in your groin, places where your body moves and flexes. Okay. It's also parallel to the vascular system and does pick up some passive propulsion from being next to the heart, the vascular system. All right, the respiratory system. Major organs are the lungs, the alveoli that make up the lungs, the bronchi, trachea, larynx, sinus, and nasal cavities, which is how we get the air down to the lungs. So the primary function is to get air to the alveoli, where we're able to do gas exchange with the blood. So this is where oxygen comes into the bloodstream, carbon dioxide leaves the bloodstream. And we also use the respiratory system for phonation, or the production of sound. The digestive system. Organs. Teeth, tongue, pharynx, esophagus, stomach, small intestines, large intestines, liver, gallbladder, and pancreas. The point here is that all of these organs work together to process and digest food, to absorb these nutrients, to conserve water, and then in the liver to store some of these nutrients and as energy reserves in the form of glycogen and fat, but mostly, hopefully, glycogen. All right. The slide is in there. I'm going to keep going. And you can get all this in the Moodle. The urinary system. The kidneys, I already alluded to this with this sort of grotesque experiment of Galen. The kidneys, the urinary bladder, and then the urethra. So this is the excretion of waste materials from the blood, water-soluble waste materials. All right, it helps control water balance and electrolyte balance. And it also, the bladder stores the urine before elimination. It helps to regulate the osmolarity of the blood, the pH of the blood, the ion concentration of the blood. We'll talk about the urinary system in fair detail. Unfortunately, we're not going to get to talk about the reproductive system at all, but the male reproductive system, the testes, epididymis, ductus, deferens, seminal vesicles, prostate, penis, and scrotum. You know, the male reproductive system is one half of the equation for human reproduction. It produces gametes. It also produces androgenic hormones that help guide the gender traits in a male. On the other side is the female reproductive system, comprised of the ovaries, uterine tubes or fallopian tubes, the uterus, vagina, labia, clitoris, and the mammary glands. So this is the other half of that equation. It produces the female oocytes or eggs, and has the place for the fertilized eggs to grow into an embryo and then a fetus, then delivering that fetus into the world as a baby, and then supporting that child with milk to nourish the newborn infant. I would love to be able to talk about the male and female reproductive systems and embryology and development, but that's a whole course in and of itself, so I'm not going to get a chance to talk about that at all. All right, on to the concept of homeostasis. Does anybody need a break? Everybody good? Because I'm a tank. I'll just keep trucking. But if you need one, you can take one now. All right. Homeostasis. The fundamental principle of physiology in which all body systems are working together to maintain a stable internal environment. This is the notion of control mechanisms. All right. So there is stimulus coming in. A homeostatic system is gathering information. It's processing that information, whatever that metric is, whatever that observable, that measurable quantity that the homeostatic system is monitoring. It is referenced to some sort of set point, and depending upon that comparison, there's an outcome. There's some sort of action that is taken, okay? And we'll see that in more detail in a moment. So a body fluctuates in dynamic equilibrium within a limited range around this set point. There's a couple different types of homeostasis. There's negative feedback. This helps keep some variable close to this set point. All right. There is also positive feedback, which are mechanisms, homeostatic mechanisms, designed to drive something away from a set point. We'll talk about that. Loss of homeostatic control can cause illness or death. You sit here, you know, if I'm going to sit and do some kind of yoga move here, and you may think that you're just standing totally still. Right? But I'm not. If you stand somewhere with your eyes closed and you really pay attention to your body, you'll notice that your body may sway a little bit to the side, and these muscles over here in this leg fire a little bit to bring you back towards balance. But then you overcompensate in muscles over here. There's this constantly shifting line running down your body that is helping you maintain balance. That's the notion of homeostasis, okay, as it's applied all over the various organ systems. So I have this was first articulated by this guy, Walter Cannon, in the early 19th century. And I put this picture of this clown on a ball because it's kind of like that. He seems to be just standing there, motionless. I mean, he is in a picture. But if we were in the room with him, he's standing there seemingly motionless, but he's not. His legs are firing. If you were to take traces, electromyography traces of his legs, you would see that this leg would fire, and then that leg would fire, his core would be firing, and it would cycle in all these patterns that are helping to keep him upright on that ball. All right. So here it is in schematic. We have a regulated variable. This is some sort of property that's going to be controlled. Maybe it's body temperature. Maybe it is blood pH. Maybe it is, I mean, there's a whole host of different things that can be homeostatically regulated. This whole notion, and I don't know if I drove this home enough, this notion of homeostasis is one of the very core, one of the very foundational principles of physiology. All right. So when we talk about physiological process, it's often some sort of homeostatic process that we're describing. So the set point is the desired value for that regulated variable.
We have here a sensor. This is some way the body has of monitoring this variable. The information this sensor gleans, it sends to some kind of integration center.
It's some part in the body that has a set point that it's comparing the data that's being sent back from this sensor.
And then depending upon the outcome of that comparison, it sends a signal to an effector.
The action of the effector
has a direct effect on whatever this variable is. It's either going to cause an increase or a decrease in that regulated variable, depending upon the comparison to the set point.
We have this element up at the top, the feed-forward controller. These are outside mechanisms that can influence this homeostatic cycle. There's not always feed-forward control. But an example, for example, is the normal anticipatory regulation of the heartbeat. So I have been sitting in the chair, sleeping, or kind of taking notes, kind of drifting off, and I realize I have to go to the bathroom, so I'm thinking about getting up, my heart rate begins to go up. It's feed forward control. The muscles aren't actually calling for the blood yet because I'm not using the muscles at all yet, but there's external stimulus from the brain that's acting as a feed forward control. All right, so negative feedback prevents change, positive feedback perpetuates change. All right, so we'll talk about negative feedback here. There's autoregulation in tissue. There's two different ways we can have a negative feedback loop. Tissue itself can regulate itself. There are many examples of tissue that is self-regulatory. And this is called autoregulation or intrinsic regulation. So some sort of cell, tissue, organ, whatever, is monitoring an environmental change, and then it's going to have a response to that that's going to affect whatever the initial condition was. Then there's extrinsic regulation, or regulation that is outside of the tissue that is being affected by the variable. So these responses can be controlled by the nervous or the endocrine systems. We have some sort of cell, tissue, or organ that is being affected by a variable, and it communicates with the nervous and endocrine system, which then processes and exerts the control extrinsically on that cell, tissue, or organ. Okay. Homeostasis. So here is an analogy. I think I've already kind of described this, but temperature, a thermostat, is a lovely example of a negative feedback control mechanism. We have some sort of receptor. All right, and we'll start right here at normal room temperature. Get myself a pointer, don't I? We start with normal room temperature, but the room gets cold because the air is off and it's January. So the thermometer registers a dropping temperature. And it's sending this information to the control center. The control center has a set point. We set the temperature that we want the room to be. And there's some little mechanism, some logic circuit, super basic logic circuit in there, that compares the temperature from the thermometer to the set point. And if the temperature coming in is lower than the set point,
Well, it just says, turns on the heat or the air conditioner, as it may be. Okay? And then it brings that temperature up above the set point, and it clicks it off when it gets too high. And then the temperature begins to cool off again, and et cetera. So the temperature in a room is oscillating up and down, right around the set point. Same thing happens in the body. We have normal body temperature. That temperature is disturbed for some reason, and these receptors in the skin pick this up, send a note to the brain. This thermoregulatory system in the brain says, oh my gosh, I'm really cold, and decides to send commands to the sweat glands, perhaps if you're too hot, to try to have evaporative cooling. Or maybe the blood vessels will dilate, you'll become flush if you're hot. Or on the other side, maybe you're cold and it's going to cause you to shiver. It's going to send blood to the core. The body temperature goes up, maybe this system then turns off. Okay. There's some other examples. Here is postural change in blood pressure. So person gets out of bed. Has anyone jumped out of bed first thing in the morning? Did this happen to anybody this morning? They jumped out of bed, like, excited to get here to class, and whoa, they went to gray and conked out. Well, you get out of bed, and blood drains from the upper body. You get this homeostatic imbalance. The baroreceptors in the carotid bulb here along the carotid notch at the bifurcation of the common carotid, they pick up on that rapid change in blood pressure going to the head. And it sends a signal to the brain stem in particular, which says, hey, the blood pressure just dropped because of whatever, like we just stood up and have to go get a cup of coffee. Let's get the heart pumping to get that blood pressure back up. So the cardiac acceleratory center sends a signal to the heart, pumps up the vascular output, and then the blood pressure rises to normal and homeostasis is restored. This is why particularly older people are prone to going gray, blacking out, when they get out of bed too fast themselves. It's because these baroreceptors in the carotid bulb and the aortic arch are often sclerotic when you get old, and the body is not as good at picking up the changes in blood pressure. And consequently, it's not getting enough of a signal coming this way, and they stay at low blood pressure. The heart doesn't respond the way it's supposed to, and they get dizzy and fall over and break a hip or knock themselves on the head or break an arm, something like that. That it's a common problem for particularly old people. Oops. Okay. Positive feedback. So this is the other side of it. This is when we want to push a homeostatic system away from a stable state. So it's a way, it's a normal way of producing rapid changes in the body. Here's an example. Hemostasis. You cut yourself. There's bleeding. The cells that got cut release various chemicals. This starts this truly complex biochemical cascade called clotting. We could teach an entire jam plan just about blood clotting. It's an incredibly complicated process. But it starts this clotting cascade, which this ambiguously says additional chemicals are released. And as these chemicals are released, it it causes more chemicals to be released and more, it's sort of like the viral spreading of a meme or something. You can think of it like that. The more you spread it, it gets amplified, etc. So as this proceeds, the blood clot gets plugged in the vessel wall and the bleeding stops. As that happens, it begins to slow down this part of the process and eventually it gets turned off. All right. But this phase here, this is a positive feedback loop. This is going to be a negative feedback loop over here, but this is the positive feedback loop. We're trying, as soon as we realize that there's a problem, we're trying to have as rapid a response to stabilizing it as possible. All right, so we want to rapidly cause clotting. At a certain point, though, we want to be able to turn it off, and that's why there's this negative feedback loop that's not really depicted here. Some other examples: contractions during childbirth. When you have a contraction, it's going to cause the experience of having that contraction, the sensation of having that contraction, makes the subsequent contraction come quicker and more intense and last longer than the one that happened before it, and so on and so forth. That's a positive feedback loop until you get to the point where the contractions are really intense and the baby is traveling down the birth canal. Protein digestion in the stomach. When you get proteins down there, you know, a large protein, you have a chunk of tofu or something, and it breaks down those small, the few amino acids that get released by digesting the protein cause an acceleration of the digestion process, okay? Having a fever is positive feedback. Ovulation, lactation, milk letdown. When a woman lets milk down, the more milk comes down, the more her body's making milk, because it's time to feed the baby. And the generation of nerve signals, which we'll talk about in pretty gory detail. So I've already talked about this. Here's just a depiction. As the infant's head presses upon the uterine wall along the cervix, it sends a signal to the woman's brain. This signal produces oxytocin, which has a whole host of effects on the body. Oxytocin, amongst other things, causes the uterine wall to contract further. It also makes the woman immune to a certain degree to the incredible, the incredibly intense sensation of that contraction. It can be quite painful for some women. It's the oxytocin that enables the women to rise to that. Okay. So for any homeostatic system, it's essential to be able to communicate. And that's one thing that you'll notice in all of this is about communication. We have two forms of communication. We have electrical communication, which is obviously part of the nervous system. So we have an incoming electrical signal that gets transmitted along the length to the dendrites and then synaptic neurons, and then there is some chemical release across the synapse in the neurotransmitter. The second type is chemical communication, and this is mostly done by the endocrine system. We have some sort of endocrine tissue that releases chemicals into the bloodstream, travels through the bloodstream until it reaches the target cell, which is going to act as the effector in the homeostatic signal system. So whether you're using an electrical or a chemical form of communication is going to be dictated by these three requirements, the requirements of distance, speed, and distribution. Is it a short distance? Or is it long? If it's short, we can use either paracrine communication. This is neighboring cells. So there's some sort of signaling cell that's going to target a neighboring cell.
or autocrine. This is self-stimulation. This is the intrinsic regulation I was talking about earlier. Remember I was talking about intrinsic and extrinsic? This would be, autocrine would be a form of intrinsic regulation where you have some sort of cell in a tissue that is stimulating and regulating itself. Okay. And then say there's a longer distance. Well, you can get somatic nerves, the nerves in the body. Somatic just means body. Somatic nerves help with longer distance, the requirements of longer distances. Speed. Does it need to happen really fast? If so, let's use nerves because they work quickly. Does it need to happen slowly? Well, then let's use that endocrine system. And what's the distribution? Does it need to be a single muscle cell in the eye? Like, do we see a flash over here and our eyes immediately move to that? Or is it a diffuse distribution? A single flash would be a nerve that would cause a focus distribution would require a nerve, perhaps, that requires you to have a very focused and discrete reaction. However, maybe the werewolf has walked into the room. And so we need a diffuse reaction throughout the entire body with maybe epinephrine or something. Okay. So here's just a chart. You can look over this. I'm not going to go through it in much detail, but it's just listing different internal characteristics. These are the variables that I was talking about that can be, this is a short list, it can be much longer, of just various variables or features of the body that are regulated by homeostasis, blood pressure, waste product concentration in the kidneys, blood fluid volume, composition, and temperature. Talks about the organ systems that are involved and what they're doing. All right, so I'm going to now focus down into a single homeostatic process. And this is my way of introducing the skeletal system. This is really, it's related to that. So it's the homeostasis of calcium in the body. Calcium truly does a body good. It's essential for neurotransmission. We'll talk about that a little bit when we get there. It's essential for muscle contraction. It plays a crucial role in blood clotting. Any kind of exocytotic process, that an exocytosis. What is exocytosis? Is that someone going to tell me? Anyone know? No one's heard of that term before? Exocytosis. Here's another thing. If there's ever a word that I use and I just assume that you know it, you got to stop me and ask me, because I have known the word exocytosis for 20 years now. And so it's easy for me to forget that not everybody has known it for 20 years. You got to remind me if I don't do a good job at reminding myself of that. Never be afraid to stop me, raise your hand, and ask a question, or anybody else. And if they don't like it, then I don't think their head is in the right place. Ask a question. It's how you learn, okay? Exocytosis is the process by which a cell takes a vesicle or a little compartment and merges it with the membrane, the outer membrane, to release the contents of that little compartment, that vesicle. Exo meaning outside, cytosis, cyto meaning cell, osis meaning, ooh, I don't know. But exocytosis means getting rid of stuff. Any kind of exocytotic mechanism is going to require calcium. And in fact, this neurotransmission is just a form of exocytosis, one form of exocytosis. So calcium is really important. There's about a little over a kilogram of calcium in an adult body. It's about 2.5 pounds of calcium in the body. And the vast majority of that lives in the skeleton. So as adults, 18% of your skeleton is exchanged. The calcium, 18% of the calcium in your skeleton is exchanged with the blood each year. So, yeah, I mean, that's about 220 grams of calcium that is taken out of the skeleton and then replaced with new calcium. So your skeleton does change with time. Even if you're like, wow, I've looked the same. I don't look much different this year than I did last year. Although you guys are still kind of growing a little bit. But I don't look a whole lot different. My skeleton doesn't, at least. Even so, the calcium does exchange. So in the plasma, in the plasma of your blood, the calcium ion concentration is right around 10 milligrams per deciliter. That's a reference range. It's a healthy reference range. I don't really expect you to know all of these numbers, but except that out of this 10 milligrams per deciliter, about half of it is just freely ionized. It's just floating around calcium. And then close to the other half of it is bound to some kind of protein. The protein is using that calcium to fold around or bind for some reason as a counter anion to some acidic, negatively charged amino acid sticking off it. All right, the skeleton. What does it do? We've already sort of talked about that. So we've established that it gives support. What else did I say 20 minutes ago? Yeah, please. Okay, yep, it protects. Good. Very good. Your turn. You had your hand up. Starts with K. Say your name again. Oh, you weren't. Okay, sorry. Blood formation? Okay, well, yeah, movement. Let's see, we'll get to blood formation. Well, electrolyte balance, acid-base balance, blood formation. Good job. That might be everything on the list I have. Yep, okay. So support, protection, movement, the body moves. We get electrolyte balance from the skeleton. I said that there's 9 or 10 milligrams per deciliter of calcium in the blood. That's a fair bit, actually, and that's going to help maintain electrolyte balance. It also happens to help acid-base balance because of this ongoing dissolving and reformation of bone that's happening. And then, of course, yeah, it forms blood. All right, here are the types of bones. There's 6 types of bones, like broad categories. There's the flat bones of the body. Well, the long bones first. These are like levers that muscles act upon. Pretty much the appendicular skeleton is made up of these long bones. So your skeleton is broken up into the axial component and then the appendicular component. And so the appendicular component has all these long bones in it. The flat bones, an example would be the parietal bone of the skull. These are very thin flat bones. There are these weird bones called sutural bones that are not always there. In lab, I'll have a fun, bizarre story about a sutural bone. I don't know if fun is quite the right word. It's a bizarre story about a sutural bone in one of the skulls here at Colby, in the Colby collection. But we'll save it for them. The sutures between the flat bones sometimes have these little extra bones that are fit in there into the sutures. Irregular bones, an example would be a vertebra. It's just a weird bone. Short bones, an example of these are the carpal bones in your wrist. And then a sesamoid bone. The largest sesamoid bone is the patella. The sesamoid bone is like a sesame seed. That's where the word comes from. It's a little bone that is embedded in the body of a tendon. Okay, so another sesamoid bone is the pisiform bone. This bone in the corner of your palm down here. You can, if you turn your palm the right way, you can move it around because it's embedded in the flexor carpi ulnaris tendon. Okay, the patella is by far the largest sesamoid bone. Some people have sesamoid bones in tendons that nobody else has. Sometimes they just spontaneously or irregularly appear in some people in various tendons. It's a sesamoid bone. Okay. Here's a living bone dissected. Here's a dry bone. So a bone has this articular cartilage on the top. You know, I'm going to save a lot of this stuff for the anatomy class, in the anatomy lecture. We're getting short on time. I yapped too much early on. We're going to get all this material, but I'm going to move on from it. Yeah. Okay. So on the outside of a bone is this periosteum, this periosteal living cell layer. And then there's a similar endosteal layer. Endo meaning inside, peri meaning along the outside, endosteal layer on the inside of the marrow cavity. All right, now this is looking at a cross section of a long bone, for example. It is this periosteal layer that is responsible for creating new osteocytes on the outside of the bone, and it's also the layer that the tendon invests. So when a muscle is attaching to a bone, it's that connective tissue of the smooth, regular connective tissue of a tendon is integrating with this periosteal layer. On the endosteum, we have this projector is so bad. I'll see if I can get a better bulb. But this layer here of osteoid. It's not quite cartilage, but it's like cartilage. The osteoid material is sort of the nursery for new bone cells. We have these osteoprogenitor cells, which are the stem cells, and then they mature into osteoblasts, which are partially differentiated bone stem cells. Osteoblasts that will then become mature osteocytes if they are needed. An osteocyte is a bone cell. You see it right here. It has all these little tendrils that are coming off of it inside of what are called canaliculi. We'll go over that in the lab. The fourth type of bone cell comes from an entirely different cell line. It's called osteoclasts. So osteoblasts are responsible for building bone. They build new bone tissue. Osteoclasts dissolve bone. All right? So you want to have them in balance. That 18% a year represents the balanced interaction between osteoclasts breaking down bone, liberating calcium, and osteoblasts replacing bone. Okay? So this is just a picture of the inner and outer surfaces of a flat bone. I was looking at the marrow cavity of a long bone. These flat bones don't have a marrow cavity per se. We call it the diploe. There should be a little of those cool umlauts over that E. For the pronunciation, the correct pronunciation is diploe. And so in this spongy area of bone here, the diploe, which is like the marrow cavity, but there's no marrow in it, in this diploe are the trabeculae. The trabeculae. And trabeculae is related to the word like tribulation. If you have a tribulation, it's like you're following a tortuous, complicated path. the trials and tribulations of life. So trabeculae has the same word origin as that, as these complicated pathways of bone in the diploid. All right. So here's a closer look at the four cell types. The first three that I have here are actually just evolutions of the same cell type. And you know what? I should have these backwards. This should be one, this should be two, and this should be three, because this is the one that comes first. I need to go back and redo this slide. These are from embryonic mesenchymal stem cells, and they get the development of these gets stimulated by stress or fracture. Stress meaning impact exercise. You go out, you do some exercise of some sort, you like to jump around, you lift a weight or whatever you do, and it's going to increase bone density because you're stimulating osteoprogenitor cells. Osteoprogenitor cells become these osteoblasts. Osteoblasts, unlike osteoprogenitor cells, are non-mitotic. They're not going to divide. Osteoprogenitor cells can divide. The osteoblasts will not divide. They're going to secrete this hormone called osteocalcin. So this increases insulin production by the pancreas, and it's going to increase insulin sensitivity in your fat tissues. It's these osteoblasts that lay down this osteoid matrix, this osteoid tissue, which is going to become the matrix of a mature bone cell, as an osteoblast is going to develop eventually into an osteocyte. So the osteoblast produces osteoid, and then one of them will become an osteocyte. It's this osteocyte that converts the osteoid to matrix by depositing this stuff called matrix. We'll talk about it in another slide in more detail, but it's going to lay down calcium and phosphate. It's regulating calcium and phosphate. They live in what are called the lacuna of the bone, and they are responsible for the actual repair of damaged bone tissue. And then finally is this osteoclast. These are polynucleate cells, multinucleate cells, many nuclei in a cell. It comes from a megakaryocyte, which is a type of cell that is formed by the fusion of multiple cells. That's why there are so many nuclei here. It's going to secrete different acids and enzymes that are going to break down the bony matrix. All right. Osteoclast development. What do I want? So the important thing here, because we're running out of time, remodeling results from combined actions of bone dissolving osteoclasts and bone depositing osteoblasts. That's the important point of all this. Okay. What is bone matrix? About a third of it is organic matter. This is the dry weight. So this is different collagens, glycosaminoglycans, proteoglycans, glycoproteins, different organic molecules that are being made by the the osteocytes. And then about two-thirds of it is inorganic matter. This is a type of ceramic. It's a type of ceramic called hydroxyapatite. And about 85% of it is this, and then about 10% of it is just calcium carbonate. Right? So this is a picture of what that ceramic hydroxyapatite looks like, and this is the osseous tissue matrix that is originally laid down by the osteoblasts and the osteoid. A lot of osteo words here, I'm talking about bone. Okay. The Haversian system. Haversian system, Haversian is an eponym named after some person that I actually don't know the story of. But they are these canals
that run throughout a bit of dense bone that transmit the artery, vein, and nerves through these nutrient foramina. A foramen simply means a hole in bone. A hole in a bone is a foramen. And a nutrient foramina, or nutrient foramen, foramina is the plural, is where these arteries, nutrient arteries, get in and pass through these things called Volkmann canals. We'll talk about the anatomy a little bit more in anatomy class. I'll move on. So the thing, I don't even need to make this point, actually. It's just this is an example of structure and function. If you look at the different patterns of spongy bone that have been laid down in a bone, you can divine the types of stresses, mechanical stress, that a bone is subject to. So this gives you maximal strength with minimal weight. Maximal strength in the way that that bone is intended to be strong, okay? So these trabeculae develop along a bone's line of stress. I should cut that one out in the future. Red marrow is in the axial skeleton. I told you that axial skeleton is, picture's bad, bones along the central axis of the body. The appendicular skeleton are your appendages. So in the appendicular skeleton, it's mostly red marrow. This is where we get red blood cells from. And then yellow marrow is found in the adults, and that it becomes really just fat as you get older and no longer produces blood as you age. All right. So bone development. Calcification and ossification are two different things. Ossification, or osteogenesis, is the formation of bone. So laying down the osteoid, converting osteoid to matrix, part of that process is called calcification. And it's simply calcifying that matrix, laying down calcium in the matrix, okay, building that hydroxyapatite. There are two forms of bone formation. There's called intramembranous ossification and endochondral ossification. This intramembranous ossification is what you'll see in a flat bone, like a parietal bone in your skull. It is like a membrane, and inside the membrane they begin to lay down bone in a flat sheet. And then there's this endochondral ossification that happens in long bones. So they grow from the ends. They grow from the ends. There's the notion of interstitial growth versus appositional growth. So an interstitial growth is a growth in length. So we see here the growth plate up at the top. I wonder if I come out here. If it gets closer. Nope. That growth plate is extending the length of the bone, whereas appositional growth, the bone grows in width. And this happens throughout life. Your bones actually get thicker as you get older. And it's partly because these osteoclasts are going to enlarge that cavity, and the bone itself is just spreading out and getting larger with age. So bones remodel throughout your life. So I said 18% of the calcium is turned over. About 10% of the actual mass of the bone is turned over per year in your life. All right, this is controlled by hormones. Do I want to go into this? No, because I want to be done here. It took too long in the beginning. I don't actually think there's anything I need to go over here. This is important, though. So calcium homeostasis is regulated by three hormones. These are calcitriol, calcitonin, and parathyroid hormone.
And they regulate calcium homeostasis in three tissues. The bones, this is where calcium is stored. In the digestive tract, this is where we're getting new calcium. All right, we're bringing new calcium into the system through the digestive tract. So we're going to effect control over calcium homeostasis there as well as in the bones. And then finally, in the kidneys, this is where calcium is eliminated through excretion. We're also going to control, effect calcium homeostasis through action on the kidneys using these three hormones. This is a little bit of a diagram.
Oh, God. I have to make sure to get a new ball. This is a diagram of what that homeostatic process looks like in detail, but I've got some better ones, I think. So first, calcitonin. Calcitonin lowers your plasma calcium levels. Say you've got too much calcium, hypercalcemia, in your blood. Pretty rare. But you have too much calcium. So excess calcium, calcitonin is secreted. It's going to reduce the osteoclast activity. Does that make sense? What do osteoclasts do? Say it loud. They dissolve the bones. Osteoclast dissolves bone. Liberating calcium. We want to turn them off. We got too much calcium in the blood. Okay? And they ramp up the osteoblasts. This is going to help deposit calcium. So those two things return the blood to normal. This is the effect on bone. Other things. Calcitonin affects the kidneys. It allows the kidneys to excrete calcium. More calcium is going to pass out of the body through the urine. It also prevents absorption of calcium through the gut. All right? Parathyroid hormone. The goal of parathyroid hormone is to increase plasma calcium concentrations. So your blood is, and this is more common, comes from the parathyroid hormone. If your blood is low in calcium, it's going to increase osteoclast activity. You're going to dissolve some bone, give you more bone resorption, increase calcium circulating. It's going to turn down the osteoblasts. You're going to form less bone, all right? So that more of the calcium is in the bloodstream. You're going to excrete more phosphate in the urine. So the relative ratio of calcium and phosphorus is going to favor calcium, all right? Because it's the calcium and phosphate balance that is needed to make the hydroxyapatite. And you're going to excrete less calcium.
What's the hydroxyapatite?
The hydroxyapatite is the ceramic, the inorganic ceramic that is part of the bony matrix. Yeah.
And we're going to conserve some calcium. Parathyroid hormone increases the rate of intestinal absorption. So if you have good parathyroid hormone levels, when you have a glass of milk or whatever, eat some kale, wherever you're getting your calcium from, you're going to absorb more of it. Less of it's going to pass out of your body in the feces. And you are going to retain more of it in the kidneys.
Similar action of calcitriol. So calcitriol is a synthetic, biosynthetic, downstream derivative of vitamin D, vitamin D3, cholecalciferol. We get exposure to light
and the liver and kidneys convert this vitamin D to calcitriol. Calcitriol has effects, again, on the three, on the bone, the kidney, and the intestine, in much the same way as parathyroid hormone does. All right. So,
this is the same thing. It's just a different diagram saying the same thing, putting them all together, both the all three hormones on the same chart. And again, the same. So I'm not going to, you can look through these different ways of describing it, but it's all exactly the same thing I've already said. And now that's sort of the end of the core.
This is just talking about some pathology. Many
older people, particularly women, have problems with osteoporosis. That is bones that have these pores. This is from overactive osteoclast activity and underperforming osteoblast activity.
There's all kinds of different chemical ways you can deal with it. There's estrogen replacement therapy. As a woman goes to menopause, her estrogen drops off, and this is going to affect bone it's going to increase bone resorption by osteoclasts when there's not enough estrogen around. ERT can slow this. There's a bunch of drugs you can use to kill off the osteoclasts. Parathyroid hormone can slow bone loss if given daily, but it has its own problems. So none of these ways is ideal. The best thing is prevention. Right now, all of you, this point in your life, this is the time to start thinking about it from your early 20s onward. Getting regular exercise, keeping your stress down, and having the appropriate diet. It's this window from the ages of 20 to 40 that you set patterns that will affect your physiology when you get to be the ages 60 to 80, which is what you should be worried about. So it's like investing in the future. The choices you make now will impact your life later. Okay. We won't go into how horrible it is, exercise, hormone, blah, blah, blah. Must be an old version. I thought I'd cut all this out. So you can look at parathyroid hormone versus plasma calcium and plot that relationship out. So this is increasing parathyroid hormone on a log scale. This is a linear scale of plasma concentration of calcium. And this is where most people are. When you get this log, correlation printed, you can find where you may be outside of this normal range, and it's indicative of a number of types of different pathologies. So knowing PTH levels and circulating calcium is an important diagnostic tool. And the last slide here is, here's some pathology on the other side where there is a dysfunction with bone remodeling. The bone osteoblasts are laying down too much bone and in patterns that are not correct. So we get this fibrodysplasia ossificans progressiva, FOP. It's a genetic disorder with 100% penetrance and leads to these bizarre skeletal malformations in these people. This is what the elephant man had, if you've ever heard that that sad story. Yes? It's a description of the genetic expression on that gene. Yeah, I'm not going to go into a long description of that right now. But it's just talking about how it's being expressed on that gene pool. So here's a picture of a patient and then her skeleton after she passed away. Maybe it was a male. I don't know if it's a male or female. So
one of the things about this disease is what happens is in the smooth, regular connective tissue, basically the tendons of these people, the body begins to form bone tissue instead of muscle tissue. So wherever there are muscles in this person, they tend to form bone instead. And so that's what leads to these really strange skeletal malformations. But interestingly, the diaphragm, tongue, and extraocular muscles are spared. I went a few minutes over. I apologize for that. But we are going to convene in 307 for a lab in just a moment here. Were there any questions? Yeah.
Would the absence of the thyroid, like if you had a thyroidectomy, affect your ability to maintain calcium homeostasis?
Absolutely. So yeah. Well, you can't have a thyroidectomy without a parathyroidectomy. So, yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
So those people have hormone replacement therapies.
So it is just replacement with just thyroid hormone replacement enough to...
Thyroid hormone? No.
I have a thyroidectomy, and they took one of my parathyroid glands.
Oh, okay.
But I don't do anything to maintain calcium?
Yeah, well, you still have two parathyroid glands, so you should be okay for now. You may have thyroid insufficiency as you get older, but I imagine you have an endocrinologist that you're seeing, right?
Yeah, but so the calcium tonin, it says released or secreted by the thyroid gland?
Yeah.
So if I were to have high calcium levels, would my body, are there other places that secrete calcium tonin? Or is that the primary source?
That's the primary source, yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah. Any other questions? Okay. Is everybody feeling okay? Does anybody feel a little bit nervous about this class? Don't be shy. If you need to talk to me, you just come and talk to me at any point. Okay? You're gonna be fine. I'm here to help you. Okay.